Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening in regard to the time you're watching this video. So in this video presentation, I'm going to talk about a book named Modern Value Investing by Sven Carlin. So firstly, I'll tell you the reason why I chose this book. So while going through the book reviews on internet or on Amazon, I came across that everybody said that this book in very simple terms helps you achieve your financial goals, and I'll be probably earning next year. So I wanted to start early and use the compounding factor of investing. So coming to the book. So the book is divided into three parts. The first is talks about the mindset a value investor should have. Second talks about the technical tools you can use to achieve margin of safety. And third talks about going beyond value investing, that is lowering your risk and increasing your potential returns. So coming to the part one, which talks about the mindset of a value investor, four things you need to keep in mind. So the first is investing is done to achieve a future goal. So if your current life decisions are based on that investing, you probably your decision will totally be irrational, because you won't be able to take extreme decisions, have the courage to take extreme decisions according to the bargains available. Second is you have to be a contrarian. So if the market is doing very well, just keep quiet and you should sell. And if the market is doing bad and everybody is just selling, just wait for the appropriate bargain available that meets all your criteria and just buy. The third is that value investing is very boring because it requires thousands of research analysis. And the fourth is value investing is not correlated to stock market. So there may be few years when your stock may underperform, but you'll surely finish your marathon with satisfying returns, that is achieving your financial goal. So from these four understanding, we can make out some characteristics of the value investor. That is for the first characteristic is you should be able to differentiate between intrinsic value of the intrinsic value of the investment and the market created illusion pricing. The second is a value investor must know how to take advantage of other people's emotions. So let me explain this with an example. Suppose you are a partner in a business, and the other partner every day is selling you his stakes at different prices. When he is happy, he is charging high prices, and when he is gloomy, he's ready to sell at a very low price. But you have the option to decline that offer because you know tomorrow again a new offer will come. So same way the market works. And obviously it goes without saying that a value investor should be optimistic when everyone around him is being pessimistic. So the book states that market is irrational, and that's where behavioral finance comes into picture. The basis of behavioral finance is that people take very irrational decisions when it comes to their finances, which brings into light two theories, prospect theory and risk aversion theory. So the prospect theory states that people treat losses and profits very differently, and investors base their decisions on perceived gains, not on perceived losses. So we'll understand this with an example which was in the book. Very good example. Suppose there are two investment advisor advising about the same fund. So the first says that there is an average 10% return, while the second advisor says that in the past decade there has been above average returns, but few years before the average has started declining. So according to prospect theory, mostly investors will choose the first advisor because they base their decision on perceived gains. Second is loss aversion theory, which states that people hate losing money, so they treat They for them loss and profit of the same amount, they treat it differently. Losses affect them more even if the amount is same. When we talk about investing, the first thing that comes to our mind is risk. So risk in value investing, the lower the risk, the higher is the potential return, which is honestly very opposite to what we have learned, what I have learned personally. So value investor says risk is permanent loss of capital, and what markets define as risk is just volatility, and volatility is a friend of value investor. So the most important measure of risk for value investor is the price the value investor pays and the value he is getting. So risk will be defined on a personal level. It will be defined as not achieving your personal goal. The next I'm gonna talk about is expanding value investing mindset. So value investor should be able to distinguish between stock fluctuation and business reality. Sometimes stock prices are detached from the reality. Let's take in a recession scenario where the stock prices are crashing and everybody is selling at whatever price they can. Even the pharmaceutical company share prices drops, but it's a necessity good. So market constantly offers huge bargain investment opportunity if you are able to distinguish between erratic market behavior and underlying business fundamental. Obviously, optimism is the key. So you should buy the stocks whose value is screaming at you, even if the herd is blinded by the short-term market drop. So this brings us to the end of part one. The second part of the book talks about various tools to increase margin of safety. The point is to limit the probability of being wrong, because in value investing the main focus is on limiting the risk. So because of time constraint, I'm going to consolidate various tools and provide an understanding. So the first is to find out the intrinsic value of the business. This can be done with different valuation method, that is NPV, net present value, that is equals to present value of future cash flows minus stock price. So when this value is positive, then only our investors should invest. Because value investing talks about increasing the margin of safety, so we have to be very conservative while doing valuation. The second method is liquidation. In liquidation method, we assume that the business is going to stop being a going concern. So we realize the assets at the market value, which is usually 30 or 50% less than what is registered in the balance sheet, because again, being conservative, and we eliminate all the intangible assets. This is an old strategy but provides a good addition checking point when analyzing investment. The next is we can also find intrinsic value of investment by using free cash flow method, and also we can use return on invested capital. So a higher the return on invested capital, the higher is the stability in a company, and which in turn infers to a higher margin of safety. When we combine these components, we get a range of intrinsic values. Again, the idea is to find a range and invest accordingly, because obviously there can be no precision. Three easy ways to calculate margin of safety is, first is net cash per share, where you divide the cash and cash equivalents minus debt divided by the shares outstanding. And if the value of price is below the net cash per share, so we invest. And also check the dividend sustainability by seeing it historically, if in case of any cyclical downturn or recession, how the company's dividends reacted in form of any change from the competitor. If the dividend was tight and any change from the competitor made the dividend questionable, so obviously there is really no margin of safety. The next category is the quantitative tools to analyze the risk of a company. So let us start with finding a business moat, which includes business moat means finding a defense which cannot be threatened by any other business. Some factors which can be used to determine business moat are low cost providers, high switching cost, brand value, network effect, and government support. Second is analyzing the management of the company, analyzing the quality of earnings, analyzing the cyclicity of the sector, which means if seeing the demand supply trend, and if the supply is constrained with demand growing, then we have a winner. And also analyzing the economy, because recession will come. It may not be evident at this point of time, but it's natural, it will come, and you should prepare your model in that way. Next, the third category is how to save yourself from value traps, because value investing is very tempting, but majority of them are value traps. So first of all, you should look for catalyst, which may be in form of mergers and acquisitions, or increased operational efficiency, or anything which will unlock a future value. Secondly is you should avoid sectors which are overly competitive, because there is no value left in them. Third is see the quality of assets in the balance sheet. The fourth is look inside activity of a company. Like if the price drops and its insiders are buying its shares, which means that the employees have faith in the company. And if there is more selling than buying, which means there is a fixed reason for that happening. Again, we have talked about to take advantage of the market sentiment. But the main question here is how and where could you find bargains like this? So the answer to this question is start by looking into catalyst, which will give you a fair valuation, risk arbitrage. Invest in smaller mid-cap companies, because there is more value to be unlocked. Go global, because internationally there may be a volatility for some time, but in future it'll provide potential returns. So this brings us to the end of part 2. So there are many other concepts which go beyond value investing, and the third part talks about it. There are many other concepts which are used in lowering the risk. So the first is portfolio management. Every investment has its own individual risk, but a good portfolio lowers the overall risk. The second is a value investor should also trade, because it lets you to keep in touch with the market and allows you to take advantage of market irrationalities. The third is a value investor should know when to sell his stock. Fourth is the lowering of risk can be done through hedging, because hedging provides it's like an insurance cover. So hedging, diversification as hedging, where you diversify in not related assets. Hedging against inflation by including a risk-free asset in a portfolio. Hedging to limit currency risk by having a well-diversified international portfolio. Liquidity risk, where having a liquidity cushion allows you to take action in case of market irrationalities. So there is a new concept which the author has introduced, where everything possibly wrong can go on. So it is divided into four economic scenarios, and in that scenario, what type of asset you should invest in. So the first scenario is where the economy is growing and the inflation is below expectation. Obviously, in that scenario, you invest in stocks. The second scenario is when the economy is growing and the inflation is also growing. So in that scenario, you can go for emerging market bonds or commodities because they'll provide yield. The third scenario is where the economy is going down and inflation is increasing. So in that case, you can obviously go for gold, because the prices will be high. Fourth scenario, when the economy is going down and inflation is also going down, in that case, you can invest in treasuries. So the main idea of all weather portfolio is keep on rebalancing your portfolio. So this brings us to the end of the book. So this is the book, Modern Value Investing. Probably I should have shown it earlier. But so the things I liked about this book was every tool, every concept is explained with an example. The tools which the technical value investing tools, the author explained it with Daimler shares and balance sheet and everything. So what I learned is you should never be influenced by a market fad. You should do your due diligence, and it requires immense lot of pressure, different type of analysis, and you should also have the patience when to buy and right time to buy. So thank you for listening.